Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Who, Nazir, how are you doing?
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah, Zohair. Doing good, alhamdulillah. Excited to be doing this behind the scenes with you about this new article.
Yeah, alhamdulillah. So it's the In Pursuit of Conviction 2, and this article is going to be dealing with faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I'm really excited about it, as you mentioned. I mean, these are concepts and ideas that we've been discussing for like a decade about over this format. And the reason why we're doing this format is because I'm in Australia, you're in Canada, and we don't let distance be a barrier for us, alhamdulillah, to exchange these ideas and collaborate for this paper. And we've really been discussing a lot of these ideas for some time. And I really think that it's going to be a very significant paper because it's going to provide an alternative and more fruitful approach to the question of, you know, how can we have conviction and confidence in the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and have faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and what exactly that means.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm so excited about this article and so grateful to have been a part of the research process, this long research process that you mentioned, because subhanAllah, this article is about epistemology. How do we know what we know is true? And epistemology is really the foundation of everything else that we're talking about at Yaqeen Institute. You know, somebody can answer one question, then jump to another question. But ultimately, what is it that underlies our faith in God, our faith in the religion of Islam? What is it that draws us to this faith? It's the epistemology that we have. And a lot of people don't realize that much of what they've been exposed to out there in terms of the da'wah arguments, the popular rhetoric that they see about establishing proofs for the existence of God, cosmological arguments, and so on. A lot of people don't realize that all of these arguments buy into the existing methodology, the existing epistemology that is grounded in doubt. It is a doubt-based methodology, or manhaj al-shak, a methodology of skepticism. And that is a methodology that is fundamentally flawed and incoherent to begin with. And we're unfortunately using that to try to establish faith on such a methodology that is always open to doubt and contestable proofs. Whereas the Quran gives us the alternative. It's an epistemology that is grounded in meaning and looking at what renders life meaningful based on what are the ontological foundations by which we interpret the world around us. And so part of the significance of this is shifting our epistemology from the doubt-based approach to the meaning-based approach. You know, when you talk about skepticism, people can be skeptical about anything, and no amount of proof that you provide would ever change that person's idea because they've already defined their conception of what they would consider proof in a way that eliminates the very possibility that a proof would alter their conviction. So, for example, somebody can be a proponent of solipsism, which is the idea that nothing exists other than my own mind, you know, that the manifested in, you know, popular culture as the Matrix or thinking that you're in a dream world and as in its inception, where you think that everything around you is fake and no amount of philosophical proof could change that. And what that really is just skepticism directed towards the existence of the external reality. You can direct skepticism towards morality. People can be morality skeptics or moral abolitionists, as philosopher Richard Garner says. And what that is the idea that, well, we don't have any empirical evidence that there is such a thing as good and bad. We don't have any logical deductive proof that establishes the existence of good and bad. Why do we even buy into this concept? And somebody can say we should discard all notions of the existence of good and bad. People can be logic skeptics. They can be history skeptics. They can buy into conspiracy theories. And so it is with concepts of religion. They can be skeptical about this as well. And where is the skepticism coming from? People don't realize that they've bought into this methodology that arised in the Hellenistic phase of Greek philosophy. When you look at Socrates, skeptical about any type of knowledge that is not grounded in what he thought was a rigorous definition, and skeptical towards non-definitional knowledge. You look at Aristotle and the Peripatetics, skeptical towards anything that's not grounded in a syllogistic argument. You know, and then the ultimate manifestation of skepticism in Pyrrho of Elis, Pyrrhonian skepticism. Pyrrho's, it's alleged that his students had to pull him back from walking off of cliffs because You know, he was so skeptical, he distrusted his own senses. He would say, well, you know, I see a cliff, but how do I even know that what my eyes are communicating to me is actually a true representation of the external world? How do I know I'm not hallucinating? How do I know I see a dog, but how do I know it's actually a dog? Maybe it's a cat, you know? So this methodology of skepticism, this manhaj al-shak, actually doesn't lead to any concrete development of knowledge. And that's why what people actually pursue in life naturally, inherently, is meaning. And the Qur'an gives us that epistemology based on meaning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Qur'an, فَبِأَيِّ حَدِيثٍ بَعْدَ اللَّهِ وَآيَاتِهِ يُؤْمِنُونَ. In what a narrative, what story about life, what explanation of reality after God and His signs are they going to believe in? And Imam al-Alusi, rahimahullah, the famous commentator on the Quran, he says, what is it going to be after, what explanation, what bayan, what elaboration of meaning is going to be more meaningful, what is going to be more clear and more lucid than the Quranic paradigm that it gives us, where belief in God serves as an ontological foundation that grounds all the dimensions in our life, the spiritual, intellectual, and moral dimensions of life that allow us to believe that my life is worth living, that allows us to see our moral values of good and evil, that allows us to understand, you know, intellectually how it is that we can come to learn different things about the universe around us. So we see how the Quranic epistemology is really the centerpiece for all other kinds of knowledge that we have to develop.
SubhanAllah. This is a beautiful, beautiful summary of kind of the ideas of the article. And I think people can really get a taste at that point of how this is kind of a different approach to this whole question. And as you mentioned, you know, that philosophical approach from stemming, that Western approach stemming from, you know, Hellenistic period in Greek philosophy with the skepticism of Socrates and Aristotle and whatnot, we find that many Muslims have kind of internalized that in our times and have used that approach to try to understand knowledge and truth and certainty. And it has not come to much of a fruitful end. And at the end of it, many Muslims and young Muslims, they find it difficult to find a strong sense of confidence and conviction in their beliefs when a person is adopting this paradigm and framework. So this article is all about shifting from that, as you mentioned, to the Quranic alternative. To the Quranic alternative that shows us how can we process the world and around us in a meaningful way. What are the ontological anchorings that are necessary for us to render this entire world meaningful? And what can we not do away with? Those sorts of questions and whatnot outlined in the article. And it's something that is, I believe, going to be very beneficial and significant and hopefully, inshallah, a shift in the discourse away from that kind of Western skeptical approach and towards this kind of Quranic approach, that we can then achieve a sense of conviction and confidence in our faith from within our own tradition and from an approach that's not something that you need to believe. Like a person might say, oh, you're using the Quran to prove the Quran and this is circular reasoning. No, not at all. The Quran merely presents us with a framework and a methodology that is something that's so natural to human beings. Like every human being would approach and adopt such a methodology to understanding truth, knowledge, falsehood, those sorts of things. And so it's about internalizing that approach, that more human approach, to being able to then understand these questions of faith and the question of faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you mentioned the article really argues at its root and at the end that the just the general experience of life, what we readily witness in life throughout the day, that witnessing, that meaning that we witness, whether it's on an intellectual level, the meanings that we witness in terms of knowledge that we accumulate and concepts we understand, whether it's on the spiritual level in terms of meaning of life and the purpose of our life and what are we here for, value that we see in ourselves and in others, the recognition that our life matters and it's worth living, that sort of meaning, or meaning relating to morality, good and evil, things that should happen and shouldn't happen, the moral outrage that we feel when we see something unjust, and the warmness in our heart that we feel when we see something moral. Those are all things that we constantly witness in our life. There's no need for an argument or a proof. We readily witness that as human beings. And the whole point of the article is, when we witness those realities, it It's about, well, what's the anchor, ontological anchorage? What's the foundation of that all? What's the fulfillment of all of those instincts or all of those drives, you can say? The fulfillment of it all is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the beginning of it all is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The huwa al-awwal wal-akhir, He is the beginning and the last from this perspective as well. And that all of meaning that we see in the world that we witness requires belief and faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so there's no need to try and come up with proofs and arguments for His existence when His existence is even more obvious than the whole notion and concept of proof itself.
That's absolutely right. I mean, people will see when they read the article about the philosophical conundrum of Munchausen's trilemma, you know, which is, where do we even get these notions of proof to begin with? Where do we even get this idea that certain things are true and certain things are false? And the fundamental mistake is people look at belief in God as though it is an abstract theoretical proposition. Whereas in reality, what we see is Islam presents the arkan al-iman, the pillars of faith, not as abstract theoretical propositions, but as ontological foundations. This is what renders reality meaningful, as these are perspectives and paradigms through which we're able to have meaningful controls of reality. And somebody will say, well, you know, what about, you know, can we just do away with these different paradigms? And that's like saying, let's do away with the concept of causality, right? Like, causality is an ontological foundation. Without a notion of cause and effect, it's not something that's substantiated by empirical data or by a logical argument, but it's something you need to make that empirical data interpretable, to logically understand the experiences and occurrences around you. You need to have some ingrained notion of causality. And so it is with purpose. So it is with the notion that there is meaning and purpose behind the entire existence that we find ourselves in, and the Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has created us for a purpose. أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْنَا لَا تُرْجَعُونَ? Do you think that you have been created aimlessly, pointlessly, and that you will not return to us, right? So, you know, it's, as you said, this is something that we've been discussing, analyzing, integrating knowledge from multiple disciplines: Islamic theology, human psychology, philosophy of science, you know, integrating different insights for over a decade. And we're really excited that this material is finally coming out with the Yaqeen Institute. So it's something we really encourage people to look into, take the time to really absorb it and reflect on it.
Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. I'm very excited as well, and honored to have co-authored it with you, alhamdulillah, my dear teacher and mentor. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all and accept from all of us, and inshallah, give it a read. I really hope that inshallah will be a very significant paper in the da'wah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. Jazakumullah khairan. Any last words, Nazir?
No, just jazakumullah khairan. Really looking forward to everyone's feedback and insights and reading the article. Barakallahu feekum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum wa rahmatullah.